Hi everyone. So API questions are very a hot topic in any interview, especially if you're applying for the AppSec person, in between somewhat experienced person, and then also if you're going for security engineering kind of a position. Now in this episode, I'm going to try to cover some of the most common questions, and I'll also explain you how you should answer them. But on top of this, you should also read through all the API top 10, which is covered by the OWASP, and also perhaps also go through all the API pen test techniques that we have learned as part of the API playlist we have on this channel. So if you like this free content, please hit the thumbs up button. It's just going to take a second and it will help me immensely. And if you want to have weekly episodes, please subscribe to this channel. So let's get started. First API question I'm going to start with is scenario. So for example, let's say there is an API hosted on example.cybersecurityTV.com/API, and there is a website, right? So always the website and APIs are front end, and API are the actually doing the CRUD operations, create, read, update, delete, always hosted on a different domain. So now the website is hosted on example.cybersecurityTV.com, which is here. And now these APIs are only accessible by the website. Let's say this is the scenario. So now question is, what should be the course policy, or should you change the default course policy? I think your answer should be yes. So the default, let's say, is star. That means we have covered in the previous one of the video about the course. That means it's going to trust any domain. Since it is mentioned here, APIs are only accessible by this website, and the website domain is this one, example.cybersecurityv.com. You should obviously specify that, yeah, this is the only domain it's going to be accessible from. So that should be a answer. And then you should also explain in the interview, why do you think this should be the answer? Why do you think the course policy cannot be started? What are the risks from it? So then let's say we have other scenario where your APIs are hosted same as above, and the web is hosted at the same as above. But now APIs are also accessible by the other SDKs. So for example, there are other websites, other third-party libraries, and for example, Google APIs and maybe some CloudFront APIs. Many third-party have these APIs, Google Maps, etc. So these APIs are also accessible by the other domains and SDKs. So how do you define your course architecture, or what do you think this is a secure architecture? Now this scenario is a bit tricky, so you need to understand two things. Now suppose if you answer what you answer in this scenario, where you can make the course policy only accessible by this domain, then obviously you are setting all the other SDKs as a failure, because they won't be able to access your APIs. So that's not a good option. Let's take another option where you put it as star. If you do that, right, then the issue here is you also, of course, your APIs will be accessible by any domain, but then issue is this domain is also accessible by anyone, which we do not want, because this is just our website, web hosted. So we don't want any domain to fetch data from it. There is a lot of phishing kind of attack one can do. So that's also not a good option. So I think the secure architecture in this case should have been where you host the API separately. So rather than doing on example, let's say there is an api.cybersecurityTV.com, and then you can configure the course policy for that one as a star. So any SDKs can call it. If you know, of course, there are a few domains, you can whitelist those or allow list those. But if you don't, then yeah, you can still put a star. And then of course you need to lock down the course policy for this domain then, and that would be a much secure architecture. So when you get this kind of scenario kind of questions, try to rule out multiple options, what could be done, what is option one, option two, option three, and see what's the most secure options. And of course you need to have good fundamental knowledge on course and SOP and cookie attributes and same set, etc., which we have all covered in the API pen testing playlist. So yeah, you should definitely check those out. The next question is, what is the API rate limiting and why do you need one? So usually first you need to explain what are the risks by not having the rate limiting, right? So of course, the rate limiting risk is anyone can do brute force, right? They can do brute force on the login API, change password, password verification, like forgot password, etc. If you don't have rate limiting, there is also possible of the DDoS or DoS, and then also there is obvious, like, you know, risk with having too much load on your web servers. So these are all the risk, and that's the reason you need the rate limiting. But then the question might arise, okay, why? So if you have, let's say, some IDS, IPS kind of thing, do you need API rate limiting? That's a tricky question, because IPS, IDS are tend to, like, you know, find this kind of attacks, let's say firewall, WAF, and block it. So then the question arises, okay, if this is blocking, then why do we need to go back and do the rate limiting on the APIs? So you, in that case, you need to understand the OSI layer, right? There's application layer, network layer. Some protection only works on the network layer and some works on the application layer. And that's what this does. So that's why, suppose you have the client and like, you know, it's brute forcing the request through the rate limiting in your API endpoint. That's why if you look at the AWS API gateway, they do offer this rate limiting. I think the default is somewhat 5 or 6,000. I don't remember, but yeah, you can check it out. And of course, and you can configure as well. So sometimes, like, you know, IDS IPS would block your, like, you know, for example, if I'm doing the DoS on some website, it will block me. However, the APIs are still enabled. That means there's no rate limiting, so I can still access the APIs. So that's why you also need the API rate limiting, and this is what it does. Next set of question is, okay, can you exploit the authorization using an API? Give me an examples. So of course, right, like there is, I think this one is on the first or second on the OWASP top 10 authorization issue. And this is similar to privilege escalation. On the web, we tend to do it differently. In API, it's much more simpler. Like, there is an API called www.example.com/user/1. That means get me the user info with the ID 1, then you change it to 2 or 3, right? So that's simplest way of explaining authorization issue, where there is also sometimes, like, you know, a cookie which saves the user profile, user credentials. So like, this is a user, this is an admin, this is a super user, etc. So you can also keep rotating and try to brute force that way and try to, like, you know, get identity of the other user. So that's the but in the examples, I would always advise, like, you know, if you had found something in your testing, then probably explain that without giving out obviously any confidential information. That will be, like, you know, pretty good, because you have done it and you can explain step by step. If not, then there is a like, you know, lot of demonstration online. We have done several demonstration on this channel as well, so you should go through it and probably try it out before you explain them. I think that would be a better idea. Next question is, how do you prevent injection attacks on APIs? So I think your answer should start with by following the secure architecture guidelines, right? Because preventing injection attack is not as simple as just using parameterized query. You have to understand the semantic of the API. Like, there could be XML injection, there could be LDAP injection. And we have seen these examples, like exploiting these examples in the advanced pen test. I think there's a playlist called Advanced Pen Test where we have exploited some of these vulnerabilities. So yeah, you should understand those, like, you know, prevent, like, what are the secure architecture? First, we saw, like, you know, what should be the course policy. Then whether you should have the rate limiting or not. What about the other headers? Like, you should have CSP header and stuff. Then how is your access control managed by the API? Then, like, you know, make sure it's only responding, like, you know, JSON schema. So sometimes, like, even if the script or HTML is imposed or injected, it doesn't, like, you know, process it. So those are several ways, like, of the secure architecture, and specific to this one, injection. Of course, you need to specify like, you know, entire cheat sheet or whatever the protection we have against the cross-site scripting, SQL injection, LDAP, XML, so depending on that API. Next question is, how do you pen test the APIs? Now, the best way I would explain this is, obviously there are multiple ways. There are several integrations you can do within the API development tool like Postman. I think we saw one example a few weeks ago, Pint, and it runs like, you know, some of the scanning during the functional testing. The other way, we have another video or integration I've showed you, is you integrate Burp with the Postman. So you redirect all the traffic to the Burp, and then Burp would, you can use the active scanning or your manual testing playbook on the Burp. Other thing, like, you know, if you have, let's say, obvious, like, you know, access to API documentation, you can read through it and create your, so that should be a first step, like create the abuse cases, like, okay, this API will let you see the bank account balance. So what's the abuse case? The abuse case could be someone else can see your bank account balance, or I can change the bank account balance by using my credentials or something. So these are all the abuse cases that you should be building. And once you have the list of it, then you can easily pen test, because otherwise you are just shooting arrow in the dark. You don't know what you are trying to get. Once you have the clear set of test cases that you want to test, of course, like while you're testing, some new ideas may come up, but at least you should have some sort of head start and some initial knowledge before you start the pen testing. And the last question we're going to discuss today is, how to securely design the password recovery API. So there are two APIs, for example, API system verification codes, which would obviously send like, you know, password code or like maybe a token or a 6-digit unit code to the user's email or SMS, for example. And then user would use that to verify verification SMS token. And if that code matches, then you can recover the password or you can change the password. Obviously, ideally, we would say like, let's user change the password, you should not be able to recover the password, because if that is the case, that means you are not storing password securely. Password should never be able to recover. So then, yeah, so how do you securely design this APIs? So first thing we should definitely do is what we learned in the earlier today, rate limiting, right? You do not want an attacker, let's say if I'm able to guess the username or user ID, and I can generate like, you know, 100,000 verification codes, and at the same time I'm trying another script to bombard with the SMS, like random tokens, and I might get click and able to change the password. So to stop that, you definitely want to make sure you have some rate limiting in place per user and per IP. That's very important. Second thing is, you want to make sure these verification codes are generated are not sequential, like obviously it's not sequential, but it has to be unique and random and etc., following all the best practices. So that's another secure design. Sometimes you may also need, like, you know, some additional verification depending on the confidentiality of the application that you're dealing with. Sometimes user ID alone is not enough. You might want their date of birth, SSN, or some other identification before you can request a verification code to ensure this is the, like, you know, correct user who is requesting. And then another secure design is, keep, like, you know, user in the loop, whatever is happening with their email. So if somebody has successfully changed the password, send them notification that, yeah, your password has been changed, and if you haven't made this action, reach out or do whatever you want, like maybe change the password back or call our support center, but just keep them in the loop. So those are like, you know, some of the definitely design decisions you have to make. Otherwise, you have these APIs built by the developers, and then you propose all of this, and it's very hard to go back and change everything. So these are, like, you know, some of the like, I haven't used like common questions like access control and what is what do you call it, like CSP policy, because we have covered those already. So I wanted to like get some out of box questions. Hopefully, I'm sure like you have gone through a lot of interviews and you have heard a lot of questions. So I would really be great if you can pin down your questions so everyone can learn from it. If you like this video and if you think like, okay, we should continue and maybe I should give you more questions on maybe APIs or any other, please feel free to comment in the comment section so I exactly know what kind of videos you're looking for. If you have any other suggestion, do not hesitate. I try to read through all of them if I can, but if not, I'll still try my best. If you have any other questions, also please reach out. And yeah, I think that's about it. I'll see you guys next Monday. Yeah, bye.